Hello, and welcome to the past, present, and future of American foreign policy. The subject of the course is, well, as you can guess, U.S. foreign policy. We're really going to focus on the period from 1945 until the present. So the past that we're going to be talking about is American foreign policy from 1945 till about the beginning of the 21st century. Then the present of American foreign policy will be roughly the first two decades of the 21st century. The future of American foreign policy, well, that's anything from here to as far out as we can see. And I'll be the first to admit that I'm a historian, and historians, they don't have much farther vision into the future than ordinary people, but at least they have some context for viewing this stuff. Now, I'm really going to begin with what I call the prehistory of modern American foreign policy. So, a quick and dirty overview of how the United States got from independence in 1776 to 1945. And it's going to be quick, but the main theme is how the United States went from being a weak, relatively poor country with extremely modest ambitions regarding foreign policy. That's in the 1770s and 1780s, when it was struggling for its independent life against Britain, going from there to being the most powerful country in the history of the world in 1945. So the jumping off point for modern American foreign policy is 1945, or we could say maybe 1941 with the Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor, which brought the United States into World War II. It was then that the United States really started sort of throwing its weight around, showing that it could exercise its power on this worldwide stage. The war is one thing. I'll be talking about the war and how it shaped American expectations, but we really begin in 1945. And I'm going to look at American foreign policy from 1945 till the end of the 20th century. During World War II, a magazine publisher named Henry Luce described this period as the American century. And he was thinking, grandly, that for 100 years, the United States would dominate the world. Well, we're not 100 years out, we're 70 years out from the end of World War II, and it's fair to say that the United States has been the dominant power in the world from 1945 until 2020. But one of the questions is American power today what it was back in 1945? One of the things I'll be pointing out that in 1945, the United States, the economy of the United States was essentially equal to the economy of the rest of the world combined. And a point that I'm going to make again and again, I've even formulated into something that I immodestly call Brands's fourth law of history. And as I explain it, I just call them Brands's laws because there are no laws of history, and I don't want you to think that anybody else has to agree with these. These are just my takes on history. But Brands's fourth law says that sooner or later, countries get the foreign policies they can afford. And the United States in 1945 could afford the most ambitious foreign policy of any country ever in history. And American foreign policy from 1945 through the 1960s into the 1970s was pretty much that ambitious. No country had ever extended its influence, asserted its power around the world to such an extent in so many ways for so long. So this was a really big deal, and the United States was the term of political science art, it was the hegemon, it was the one, it was the country that called the shots around the world. Now, it's important to note, and we'll be observing how even during this time, the United States was number one. But just because you're the most powerful doesn't mean that you are all powerful. And Americans sometimes got confused about this. And they thought that, well, we're the most powerful country in the world. We ought to be able to do whatever we want. Well, not so. The United States was the most powerful, but it still had a very small fraction of the world's population. And there are lots of other people who had lots of other ideas. So we're going to look at how American policy was projected around the world during the Cold War. The Cold War lasted from 1945 till around 1990. The Cold War was this competition between the United States and the Soviet Union, between the belief system of the United States, democracy and capitalism, and that of the Soviet Union, communism and socialism. And it was this contest. Well, the Soviet side lost the contest. And so as of 1990 or 1991, if you choose the date of the dissolution of the Soviet Union, Americans who felt in a self-congratulatory mood could pat themselves on the back and say, we won the Cold War. We are the only superpower left. During the Cold War, it was commonplace to describe the United States and the Soviet Union as the twin superpowers. But the Soviet Union was a superpower really only in the sense that it had this big nuclear arsenal. Its economy was never even close to the United States in its weight, clout, extent. So, in 1990, 1991, Americans thought, boy, now there's no competition. We can really rule the world. It turns out that things were more complicated than that. And we're going to be talking about that. Now, why is it that Americans had these high expectations? That's probably the easy part. But why did the expectations not play out the way they did? So, going to be looking at this. And then we'll segue into the 21st century. And I said that we're going to be calling sort of the present of American foreign policy from the beginning of the 21st century until now. And if you want to put a particular date on it, you could say September 11th, 2001. This was the time, the date of the terrorist attacks on the World Trade Center in New York and the Pentagon in Washington, D.C. And Americans realized that as powerful as they were, they couldn't protect themselves against terrorist attack. And so there was this new kind of fear, this new anxiety that pervaded American life and shaped American attitudes about the world. The United States had no desire to go into wars in the Middle East before 9/11. But the terrorist attacks of 9/11 emanated from training camps in Afghanistan, and they involved nationals of Saudi Arabia. And so the United States felt obliged to go in and clean out the training camps in Afghanistan. This is the presidency of the administration of George W. Bush. And then Bush decided that he was going to take on Iraq, which had been a thorn in the American side for a decade before that. And so the United States got involved in wars in Afghanistan and Iraq. The war in Iraq has ended for the United States. It ended almost a decade ago now. But the war in Afghanistan still kind of goes on. It's the longest war in American history. Anyhow, so we're going to get from that moment in 1945 when the United States was up here and the rest of the world was kind of down here until we're in a situation in 2020. Well, this is what we're going to be talking about. Where is the United States vis-a-vis the rest of the world? Because power in international affairs is partly absolute. So, I mean, how much power do you have? How many dollars do you have? How many tanks do you have? How many nuclear warheads do you have? But it's also a comparative thing. And it's inarguably the case that, comparatively speaking, the United States is weaker, maybe I should just say less powerful, today than it was in 1945. In 1945, the United States had half the world's industrial GDP. In 2020, the United States has less than a quarter. So the world has really caught up to the United States. And by some measures, China has a larger economy than the United States. So, you know, the U.S. went from here and the rest of the world was down here to now we're sort of like this, where more or less equal. And then when we talk about the future of American foreign policy, what's that going to look like? Is this trend going to continue? Will China outstrip the United States, or maybe China, the world outstripped the United States in betting? If you're betting on a golf tournament, for example, you can take one person against the field. And in the days when Tiger Woods was at the top of his game, Tiger Woods was often favored against the whole field. Under ordinary circumstances, the field meaning anybody else beating this one person. So in 1945, you could take the U.S. against the field and probably win that bet. Today, if you took the United States against the field, that would be a much dicier bet. You could even get, you know, United States against China as sort of a one-on-one thing. Anyway, so these are the questions we're going to pose. We're going to look at aspects of foreign policy, sort of the usual stuff of foreign policy, the economic power and economic diplomacy, military power, military strategy, the wars the United States has fought in. We're going to look at other aspects of foreign policy, the way countries engage with each other. Some of these are informal, some of them are non-governmental. So there are organizations, well, international organizations like the United Nations and the hopes the United States had for the United Nations, at least early in the Cold War, and how they didn't quite pan out the way they did. But other organizations, the World Health Organization, which is certainly in the news these days amid the COVID pandemic. But we're also going to look at sort of other aspects of the way countries and peoples relate with each other. And so things like education. The United States has been, through much of the period we're going to talk about, a magnet for students, for foreign students coming to the United States, because the United States had a system of higher education that was in some ways the envy of the world. And so it was a big attractor, and it also had an important effect on American foreign policy, sort of narrowly described, because people from foreign countries who came to the United States during their college years got to know the United States, sometimes got to know Americans, and they took home with them when they went home certain opinions of the United States, certain attitudes toward the United States, and this allowed the United States to expand what was sometimes called America's soft power. So there was a distinction that was made, and we'll talk about this, between hard power and soft power. Hard power is the power of weapons, you know, what you can bash somebody over the head with. Soft power is the power of persuasion, to put it another way. Hard power is the power of coercion. Can you make people do what you want them to do? Soft power is the power of persuasion. Can you make them like you? Can you make them want to do things that you want them to do? Can you make them follow you? So these are some of the things we're going to be talking about. And we're going to be talking about the question of where is all this leading? So I was born in 1953. So I'm not as old as the course, not quite. But I lived through most of the, what I've called in this course, called the past of modern American foreign policy. And we're up to 2020. And so I have sort of seen a lot of the stuff we're going to be talking about. But most of you, I'm going to guess that your average age is 18, 19, maybe 20. And most of you are going to be living through the future, I'm calling the future of American foreign policy. Statistically, most of you will still be alive 50 years from now. And you will have some say over how American foreign policy unfolds. Now, I mean, some of you will take government positions. Some of them, it's not inconceivable that one or more of you might become president of the United States or secretary of state or national security advisor or work at the Pentagon or work at the Department of Commerce in foreign trade or something like that. But even if you don't have that direct kind of influence, the great majority of you are going to be voters, and you're going to have a chance to vote, and you will have that influence on foreign policy. A question of abiding interest and concern is, so what is the role of democratic governments, of democracy, in shaping foreign policy? Does the United States have a good foreign policy? Does democracy make American foreign policy better than it would be otherwise? Does it make it worse than it would be otherwise? Well, these are things that we'll talk about, but we do have democracy, and that is, you know, everybody pretty much gets to vote, and the votes that people cast have an influence, certainly, over who gets chosen to make foreign policy. Now, it is fair to say that it's rare that American foreign policy is the critical issue in any given presidential election, but it does have an effect. So you are partly responsible. You're going to be partly responsible for the way the future, what I'm calling the future of American foreign policy, unfolds. So past, present, future of American policy, foreign policy. This is what we're going to be talking about, and this is where the semester is going to take us. So, once more, welcome. Welcome to the course. I look forward to working with you, and I expect to have an interesting and worthwhile semester.